You have all heard the proverb about fools and angels, where the latter fear to tread, the former rush. In this context, I submit, I fulfill all the qualifications of being a fool, partly because I am not a specialist student of Indian history, nor am I a politician. However, it seems to me that those of us who have chosen to walk in the light of Sri Aurobindo and the Mother, although we are walking towards eternity, we have certain obligations towards contemporary life. The stature of Sri Aurobindo, the intellectual paradigm that he presented to mankind, are so comprehensive that it seems to me it should be possible for us to draw from Sri Aurobindo light in which we can address and solve the problems that have besieged us. It is in that spirit that I have taken up this topic, and for what it is worth, I'll stand before you during the next 1 hour and say whatever I have to say on this subject. Since this is a delicate subject, a friend of mine who accosted me, he said, "Is there going to be a riot?" So this is a kind of a subject where people are all excited, maybe something very extraordinarily revealing is going to be exposed today. But this is a very humble study, more an analysis of the problem than an attempt to solve it. But if the analysis is correct, then probably we have solved the problem 50%. Since it's a delicate issue, I will try to stick to my written text so that there are no exaggerations or careless phrasing of ideas. The problem of Hindu-Muslim unity has proved to be the most intractable hurdle to our national integration. And as Sri Aurobindo predicted in his August 15, 1947 message to the nation, the creation of Pakistan has only aggravated the virulence of this problem. Neither the Hindus nor the Muslims, whether in India or in Pakistan, have benefited from the partition. The challenge of coming to terms with Islam is a particularly difficult and complex one because of our peculiar history, and it seems to be our destiny to find a solution to this problem. Can we find it? Remember what the mother once said, India has become the symbolic representation of all the difficulties of modern mankind. India will be the land of its resurrection, the resurrection to a higher and truer life. India represents all the terrestrial human difficulty, and it is in India that there will be the cure. And it is with this hope that the problem of Islam, which is a universal problem, will find its cure in this country that have taken up this topic. Sri Aurobindo's writings on the Hindu-Muslim situation in India mostly belong to the period before 1910. when he was writing as a journalist for the Vande Mataram and the Karma Yogin, under the stress of events developing from day to day. That was also the time when the British administration was deliberately fanning Hindu-Muslim tensions in what is today Bangladesh and elsewhere in India. And Sri Aurobindo often attempted to expose these machinations. It is, however, not always easy to infer how exactly Sri Aurobindo would have reacted to the complexities of the current situation, muddied by the disastrous development of the last 80 years in the relationship between the two communities. However, some of the major trends which were to gather force during the subsequent decades were already perceptible during the first decade of this century, and Sri Aurobindo has commented on some of these trends. And yet, when talking about Sri Aurobindo, one must remember that his perceptions of events and his entire thinking underwent a revolutionary transformation after he took up yoga seriously a couple of years before he settled down in Pondicherry. Unfortunately, there is a further difficulty here. Whatever Sri Aurobindo might have to say on this problem is open to the charge of partisanship. Although Sri Aurobindo was primarily a mystic and a yogi with a global vision, and is one of the greatest names in the spiritual annals of humanity, he came from a Hindu stock. And for that reason alone, some people have looked upon him as the representative of the Hindu view. But to limit Sri Aurobindo to Hinduism is as absurd as characterizing modern science and technology as Christian, because they too originated in the Christian countries. There have also been some mischievous attempts in recent years to portray Swami Vivekananda and Sri Aurobindo as primarily Hindu nationalists or as champions of militant Hinduism. This is a travesty of truth. In fact, Sri Aurobindo held that the time for religions was over, and whatever their need and justification at a certain stage in human history, he believed that mankind was now entering the age of universal spirituality. He repeatedly said that his ashram and his teachings were not based on Hindu religion or culture or any religion or nationality, but on the truth of the divine, which is the spiritual ideal behind all religions, and on the truth of the supramental consciousness, which is not known to any religion. And yet, it is always possible to cite out of context from the vast body of Sri Aurobindo's writings or from his casual talks recorded from memory by his associates or from his correspondence with his associates some remark or sentence which is critical of Muslims in India or of Islam. And in the opinion of the keepers of the nation's secular conscience, that is enough to characterize him as a champion of militant Hindu nationalism. Strange indeed are the measures and criteria some of the leaders of public opinion in our country have evolved by which a person's genuineness as a secularist is to be judged. He who hopes to be counted among the accredited secularists must hold Hindus and Muslims equally guilty in every instance of communal disturbance. He should hold Hinduism and Islam equal in everything, except that he is free to damn Hindu culture and Hindu scriptures, but he should say nothing critical about Islam either in India or anywhere else in the world. Finally, a secularist must make fun of all religions. Recently, the CPIM leader AMS Nambudiri Pad has added a new twist to this confusion about secularism. For him, a fundamentalist is one who subordinates all other issues to that of religion. Although it is not very clear what AMS means by subordinating all other issues to that of religion, it would seem that according to this definition, T.S. Eliot and Dag Hammarskjöld were both fundamentalists. And what is more ludicrous is that one who exploits religion for some political end would not be a fundamentalist because his ultimate objective is secular. Sri Aurobindo makes a distinction between two aspects of religion, religion as spirituality and as religionism. He rejects religionism or sectarianism in religion and is an ardent votary of spiritualism. If that makes him a fundamentalist, then that would make Jesus Christ and Buddha two fundamentalists. I quote from Sri Aurobindo, "It is true in a sense that religion should be the dominant thing in life, its light and law. But religion as it should be and is in its inner nature, its fundamental law of being, a seeking after God, the cult of spirituality, the opening of the deepest life of the soul to the indwelling Godhead, the eternal omnipresence. On the other hand, religion, when it identifies itself with a creed and a cult, a church, a system of ceremonial forms, may well become a retarding force, and there may therefore arise a necessity for the human spirit to reject its control over the varied activities of life." Swami Vivekananda and Sri Aurobindo exemplify best the spirit of liberalism which has created out of the medieval Hinduism a vibrant modern Hinduism more than willing to reaffirm what is basic to the Hindu faith, respect for all religions. So much by way of preliminary remarks. I will begin addressing this question directly with a quotation which presents succinctly Sri Aurobindo's approach to the solution of the Hindu-Muslim problem. It is essentially a spiritual approach, and I am convinced that there is no purely external, legal or diplomatic solution to this problem, although we may have to find the external means to give a practical shape to this inner spirit of Hindu-Muslim unity. And the quotation is as follows. "Of one thing, we may be certain, that Hindu-Mohammedan unity cannot be affected by political adjustments or Congress flatteries. It must be sought deeper down in the heart and in the mind, for where the causes of disunion are, there the remedies must be sought. We shall do well in trying to solve the problem to remember that misunderstanding is the most fruitful cause of our differences, that love compels love, and that strength conciliates the strong. We must try to remove the causes of misunderstanding by better mutual knowledge and sympathy. We must extend the unfaltering love of the patriot to our Muslim brother, remembering always that in him too Narayana dwells, and to him too our mother has given a permanent place in her bosom. But we must cease to approach him falsely or flatter out of a selfish weakness and cowardice. We believe this to be the only practical way of dealing with the difficulty. As a political question, the Hindu-Mohammedan problem does not interest us at all. As a national problem, it is of supreme importance." Now, I would like to dwell on this paragraph for a couple of minutes. What exactly is Sri Aurobindo saying here? A, he is saying, you can't achieve Hindu-Muslim unity through political cleverness or by flattering the Muslims. B, this unity can only be achieved by cleansing our hearts of prejudices and by clearing the minds of misunderstandings. C, we must extend to the Muslim brother the love of the patriot, remembering that Mother India has given him too a permanent place in her bosom. D. We should not try to conciliate the Muslim brother through an attitude of weakness and cowardice. E. The Hindu-Muslim problem is a national problem, like poverty, like overpopulation. It is not a problem to be solved by political adjustments. Sri Aurobindo was opposed right from the time of the Morley Minto reforms to the deliberate attempts being made by the British regime to encourage the notion that Hindus and Muslims were two separate political units, having separate political, economic and cultural interests, because he felt that this would preclude the growth of a single and indivisible Indian nation. It is for this same reason that he was unhappy with Gandhiji's overzealousness about the Khilafat question. Gandhiji went on to declare that the Khilafat question was, in his view, more important than the urgent matter of independence. Gandhiji wrote, and I quote, "I would gladly ask for postponement of Swaraj activity if thereby we could advance the interest of the Khilafat." Quote complete. As the historian R.C. Mazumdar wrote, "If 100 million Muslims in India are encouraged to feel that they should be more interested in the welfare of Turkey and other Muslim states outside India than that of India itself, they will hardly be able to feel that they are an integral unit of the Indian nation." This meant, basically, encouraging the pan-Islamic movement in India, which cut at the very root of Indian nationality. The historian Mazumdar sums up Gandhi's role in these words, and I quote, "Gandhiji's anxiety for the Hindu-Muslim unity deserves all praise. But his was a sentimental approach to the problem and was not at all based on a realistic appreciation of the situation." Quotation complete. I am not interested here in discussing the related issues of how hard the British tried to create a wedge between the Hindus and Muslims, or how Gandhiji, in spite of his most honorable intentions, failed in bringing together the two communities. As we all know, the Hindu-Muslim problem has been rendered so very difficult because of the tormenting memories of our history. It is easy to whip up among the Hindus passions of revenge and hostility over the humility and oppression they are believed to have suffered, according to history books, over the long years of Muslim rule in India. From the Muslim side, it is equally easy to perceive independence of India as a dispensation that gives the majority Hindu community all the power and prestige and reduces the Muslims to the status of a minority community at the mercy of the majority community. It is therefore easy to whip up passions among Muslims by reminding them that not long ago they were the masters of the Hindus. So the field in India has always been fertile for bigots and fanatics, whether Hindu or Muslim, to sow seeds of disharmony and conflict and expect to reap a rich harvest of communal strife, riots, bloodshed and destruction of innocent lives. Then there is a further complication. The basis of Islam is a creed, and there is no salvation outside this creed. Because of this, a certain kind of sectarian universalism comes natural to it. Those who profess the creed, no matter of what nation, race or community, belong to a universal Islamic society. And those who do not accept this creed cannot be part of this society. As in other religions, in Islam too, there are highly evolved people who are capable of transcending this exclusiveness. But Islam in India, and in most places outside India, has not yet undergone the religious reformation or liberalization which Hinduism underwent under the impact of the intellectual, rationalistic, cosmopolitan, mundane and humanistic thought of the 18th and 19th century Europe. Modern Hinduism reflects the influence of such reformist movements as Brahmo Samaj, Arya Samaj, the Ramakrishna Vivekananda movement. Swami Vivekananda had the greatness to say, and I quote, "The Mohammedan conquest of India came as a salvation to the downtrodden, to the poor. That is why 1/5 of our population have become Mohammedans." Quotation complete. This is what Swami Vivekananda was capable of saying nearly 100 years ago to his fellow men. In a letter he wrote to a Muslim friend of his, he once said, "I am firmly persuaded that without the help of practical Islam, theories of Vedantism, however fine and wonderful they may be, are entirely valueless to the vast mass of mankind. We want to lead mankind to the place where there is neither the Vedas nor the Bible nor the Quran. Yet, this has to be done by harmonizing the Bible, the Vedas and the Quran. Mankind ought to be taught religions are but the varied expressions of the religion, which is oneness, so that each may choose that suits him the best. For our motherland, a junction of the two great systems, Hinduism and Islam, Vedanta brain and Islamic body, is the only hope. I see in my mind's eye the future perfect India rising out of this chaos and strife, glorious and invincible with Vedanta brain and Islamic body." Quotation complete. In this, Swami Vivekananda embodies the spirit of modern Hinduism. To take another example, in his essays on the Gita, written nearly 80 years ago, Sri Aurobindo had this to say about his attitude regarding the scriptures such as the Vedas, the Upanishads and the Gita. He said, "First of all, there is undoubtedly a truth, one and eternal, which we are seeking, from which all other truth derives. But precisely for that reason, it cannot be shut up in a single trenchant formula. It is not likely to be found in its entirety or in all its bearings in any single philosophy or scripture or uttered altogether and forever by any one teacher, thinker, prophet or avatar. Secondly, this truth, though it is one and eternal, expresses itself in time and through the mind of man. Therefore, every scripture must necessarily contain two elements, one temporary, perishable, belonging to the ideas of the period and country in which it was produced, the other eternal and imperishable and applicable in all ages and countries." Quotation complete. Compared to all this, very little seems to have happened in the Islamic world in the way of new movements to bring to it a comparative liberal spirit and to change the stamp of the temperament of its adherents. If anything, there has been among Islamic nations a fundamentalist revivalism which was opposed to any kind of reformist spirit. For instance, Baha'ism in Iran, which has given quite a different stamp to the temperament of its adherents, is unfortunately proscribed in many Islamic countries. And in the country of its origin, namely Iran, it remains the object of severe persecution. Compare what Sri Aurobindo had to say about scriptures with this from a leader of today's Islamic community who writes to the editor of Sunday as follows. "The Muslim, by definition, believes in the Quran, every word of it, as the word of God. He has no right to pick and choose in the Quran. He accepts it in its entirety as the last and immutable message of God to mankind. And if he questions one word of it, he is outside the pale. Therefore, he has no authority to change a word, a comma, or a full stop." Quotation complete. This fundamentalism may very well be a passing phase during which Islam is establishing its identity. And once this has been achieved, Islamic religious mind may go on to give a greater scope to its creativity. There are signs that this phase in the development of Islam is already in progress in such countries as Turkey and Egypt. Within Islam in India too, we see a tussle going on between the liberal elements and the fanatic elements as in other religions. Our attempt should be to strengthen the hands of the liberal elements and not to pamper to the whims of the fanatics for winning their votes. But it is not realism to ignore this aspect of Islam. Sri Aurobindo had a clear understanding of these facts, and therefore he recognized that coexistence with a community such as Islam required a federal spirit even wider than that which has made India the most tolerant country in the world to other religious faiths and modes of worship. Such a genuine spirit of federalism would convince Muslims that it is not the goal of Hinduism either to destroy Islam or to fuse it with Hinduism. This would necessitate evolving a formula of national unity by expanding the old idea of federalism. Sri Aurobindo was very clear on this issue so many decades ago, for he said, and I quote, "The Mohammedan, the Buddhist, the Christian in India will not cease to be Mohammedan, Hindu, Buddhist or Christian in any sense of the term." I quote again, "The Mohammedan, the Hindu, the Buddhist, the Christian in India will not cease to be Mohammedan, Hindu, Buddhist or Christian in any sense of the term, for uniting into one great puissant Indian nation. Devotion to one's own ideals and institutions, with tolerance and respect for the ideals and institutions of other sections of the community, and an ardent love and affection for the common civic life and ideal for all, these are what must be cultivated by us now for the building up of the real Indian nation." Quotation complete. The broad humanist Hinduism, which is based on the heritage of Vedanta, expounded not only by Sri Aurobindo but also by Swami Vivekananda and by such academic philosophers as Dr. Radhakrishnan and Dr. Dasgupta, it will be granted by all, is the Hinduism which has this spirit of genuine federalism. In the very first chapter of his essays on the Gita, Sri Aurobindo had the audacity to ask his readers not to be limited by the Gita, or for that matter by any scripture of the past. And he says, "We are not called upon to be orthodox Vedantins of any of the three schools or tantrics, or adhere to one of the theistic regions of the past, or to entrench ourselves within the four corners of the teaching of the Gita. That would be to limit ourselves and to attempt to create our spiritual life out of the being, knowledge and nature of others, of the men of the past, instead of building out of our own being and potentialities. We do not belong to the past dawns, but to the noons of the future." Or consider the following from Swami Vivekananda: I shall go to the mosque of the Mohammedan, I shall enter the Christian's church and kneel before the crucifix. I shall enter the Buddhist temple, where I shall take refuge in Buddha and his law. I shall go into the forest and sit down in meditation with the Hindu, who is trying to see the light which enlightens the heart of everyone. Not only shall I do all this, but I shall keep my heart open for all that may come in the future. Is God's book finished, or is it still a continuous revelation going on? It's a marvelous book, these spiritual revelations of the world. The Bible, the Vedas, the Quran, and all other sacred books are but so many pages, and an infinite number of pages remain to be unfolded. I would leave it open for all of them. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the spirit which inspired the Indian Renaissance. And if this spirit is recognized and encouraged, those belonging to the minority religions will never feel threatened by the dominant Hindu community. But unfortunately, there has been a tendency in the country to dismiss all this, the kinds of things I read out from Sri Aurobindo and Vivekananda, as another version of Hindu revivalism. The secularist wisdom in this matter decrees that either all scriptures are old wives' tales, or that the Christian should stick to his Bible, the Muslim to his Quran, and the Hindu to his Gita. It should be understood that there is bound to be within the folds of such a creedal religion as Islam a fairly strong element which regards the intolerance of other religions as the mark of a true believer. Dogmatism and fanaticism are not the exclusive bane of any particular religion. The blind obedience to an authority, whether that of a text or of a person or of some set rules, and the waning of the inner spirit of religion, its spiritual core, are blights that can affect the followers of any religion. But tolerance of other religions has never been claimed as basic to Islam, at least in India, except among the Sufis, whose influence is negligible on the opinion makers among the Islamic leadership. As Sri Aurobindo is reported to have once said in an informal chat with his associates, "You can live amiably with a religion whose principle is toleration. How is it possible to live peacefully with a religion whose principle is, I will not tolerate you? How are you going to have unity with these people?" Unquote. If such a religion finds itself in the position of a minority, it can develop a persecution complex. Then the more fanatic followers of this religion will find various means of exploiting their minority status to blackmail the majority community. On several occasions in India, we have failed to make a distinction between the moral and political blackmailing tactics of a few hooligans and the genuine aspirations for social and economic justice of the silent majority in our Muslim population. The vote arithmetic on which our democracy is based has even encouraged such hooligans. Giving in to the blackmailing tactics of such groups is dangerous to both the communities. A sentimental approach, or one which is overly moralistic at the same time, only adds fuel to this conflict situation. A firm and impartial handling of conflicts arising out of this mindset is as important for our political health and stability as safeguarding the identity of the minority religions. Otherwise, there will be a backlash from the majority groups, which will feel justified in using the force of their strength to teach the troublemakers a lesson. We have often reached such flashpoints of communal tension in India by not being honest and straight about these problems, and by taking a diplomatic attitude and resorting to political conciliation in such situations. A purely opportunistic and political approach in such a situation will never, never help us solve that situation. As I have observed above, the Hindu-Muslim conflict in India has been particularly sharp for various historical reasons. What actions or policies pursued by the majority Hindu community can be really interpreted as threatening to the identity of Muslims in India? And when any direct or indirect retaliation by the Muslims can be regarded as a legitimate way of expressing a real grievance, and when it's a mere blackmailing tactic, are difficult judgments to make. No purely rational or external or legalistic way can ever be devised to settle these questions. The only answer to this problem is for both the communities to understand each other better and move closer spiritually. If that has to happen, we must encourage within the country the liberal spirit of the kind which was the inspiration behind the Indian Renaissance. Only on a spiritual basis can Hindu-Muslim unity be realized. But as I said earlier, spirituality today is either a misunderstood or ill-understood concept in our country. Islam comes
as a great challenge to Hinduism, because Hinduism has lost its strength and dynamism it once possessed, and Islam is rightly contemptuous of all weakness. Like Islam, Hinduism too during the Vedic times had the zeal to conquer the world for God. But this was an altogether different notion of conquering the world. Intolerance towards the followers of other religions or trying to convert them to one's own religion was never a part of this Vedic sense of conquering the world for God. In the Vedic ideal, it meant bringing perfection not only to the human soul, but also to the instruments of the soul, to the human body, which is constantly plagued by disease and the threat of dissolution, to the life energies which are tormented by the vagaries of desires and the frustrations they cause, and to the mind which is constantly troubled by doubt and disillusionment. This Vedic ideal includes in it the mastery and the perfection of the external world. This emphasis on perfection of the whole of life, not just the soul, will make Hinduism dynamic and world-affirming. One of the weaknesses of Hinduism during the last millennium has been its excessive world-negating stance, which has created some kind of a debilitating block in the very psyche of Hindus. Only a return to a dynamic, world-affirming Hinduism will ever be able to conciliate Islam and win its respect. To negate the world is to admit that it does not belong to God. One can never conciliate Islam on the basis of such weakness. As I said earlier, Sri Aurobindo did not think there was any purely political or external solution to the Hindu-Muslim problem, since he held that unity must be realized within before it can manifest without. He firmly believed that the best approach to fostering the unity between the two communities was still the spiritual approach. He said, if we are to create a common sentiment, it can only be by awakening in their hearts the sentiments of common brotherhood with their Hindu fellow men. To do this, we must first nourish the sentiment ourselves. A political show or talk of brotherhood will not serve, for it will ring false to the ear of feeling, and no true unity can be effected by insincere professions. By the natural conversion of brotherly feeling into love and service, the gulf which is yawning wider and wider between the two communities may be bridged. It cannot be done by diplomacy, it cannot be done by logic, it can only be done by the appeal of heart to heart. Quotation complete. The time has come to implement these guidelines that Sri Aurobindo laid down during the early years of this century, now that we are the masters of our own political destiny. We should ask ourselves what measures we have taken to bring Muslims into the mainstream of our national life by attending to the real problems that they have been facing, namely the problems of housing and education and job opportunities. We should refuse to give in to the temptation of exploiting them as communal vote banks, because that's a sure way of marginalizing them. In my discussion here, I have deliberately avoided mentioning the current conflict between the ideologies of the so-called secularists and the so-called champions of Hindu nationalism. In my view, these secularists are motivated by genuine humanitarian considerations, but in practice, they seem to be perpetuating a mix of the political and sentimental approaches which have so far proved disastrous. Regarding the ideology of the champions of Hindu nationalism, what would Sri Aurobindo have said? It is possible to infer what Sri Aurobindo's reactions to their ideology would have been from the comments he made a long time ago in the pages of Karma Yogi in 1909 on the ideology of a group called the Hindu Sabha. This has nothing to do with Hindu Mahasabha. Hindu Sabha, which was started in Calcutta around 1908, which was started in Bengal in the first decade of this century. Sri Aurobindo said in his article about this Hindu Sabha, he says, it's very clear, and you can see what he would have felt about today's ideology of Hindu nationalism. He said, if this Hindu Sabha stood for a new spiritual impulse based on Vedanta, the essential oneness of man, the lofty ideals of brotherhood, freedom, equality, and a recognition of the great mission and mighty future of the Hindu spiritual ideals and the disciplines of the Indian race, then it would be serving a great objective. If, on the other hand, if it is inspired by motives of rivalry against the Mohammedan intransigence and by a desire to put the mass and force of a united Hinduism against the intensity of Muslim self-assertion, then it has to be regarded a retrogressive movement and must be rejected. Sri Aurobindo was categorical that Hindu nationalism had probably a meaning in the times of Shivaji and Ramdas. Possibly, it was both possible and necessary at that time, but in present-day India, such an ideology had no place. Under modern conditions, there was room only for Indian nationalism. Now, ladies and gentlemen, no reference to the Hindu-Muslim problem and Sri Aurobindo would be complete without bringing in what he said very clearly in his message to the nation on 15th of August 1947, where he very clearly said that the partition must go. Now, before I take that up and read that as a concluding quotation, I would like to summarize what I said during the last 45 minutes. What exactly Sri Aurobindo has been saying? A, Hindu-Muslim unity cannot be achieved through political cleverness or by flattering Muslims. If you look back on the history of this country, we have done nothing but this. Two, it can be achieved by all of us cleansing our hearts of prejudices and clearing our minds of misunderstandings. Dwelling too much on the past makes you a prisoner of the past. We do not belong to the dawns of yesterday. We belong to the noons of tomorrow. And the new consciousness that is coming, the new man that Sri Aurobindo is building, the schism between Hindu and Muslim will not remain. And therefore, trying to befuddle and confuse, look at future through the eyes of the past is a mistake. See, we must extend to the Muslim brother the love of the patriot, since Mother India has given him a permanent place in her bosom. Sri Aurobindo has made it very, very clear in several places that as long as India remains India, the identity of Islam, the identity of Christianity, the identity of all these religions will be safeguarded. It is the responsibility, the meaning of being a Hindu to see that the identity of other religions is safeguarded. Next, we will look back and see how we have been conducting our affairs, because Sri Aurobindo says, we cannot conciliate the Muslim brother as long as the Hindu takes an attitude of weakness and cowardice. A strong Hinduism, which loves this world as much as it loves the soul, such a strong Hinduism alone will be able to win the respect of Islam and conciliate it. Islam can never be conciliated on the basis of sentimental weakness, on the basis of cowardice. The history of this country for the last 1,000 years has been a long, long history of cowardice. The time has come when we must reassert what Sri Aurobindo calls the dynamic spirit of Vedic India, which will try to win this world for God, win not votes, not converts, but all the imperfections that beleaguer the human body, the human mind, the human spirit, and for that you need a strong Hinduism. And once this strong Hinduism is born on the basis of the spiritual revival of Hinduism, you will see no force will be able to defeat us, as we have seen during the last 1,000 years, any Tom, Dick and Harry came, knocked at our door, found the door open, just walked in. In some places, not once, but 17 times. How did this happen? What were we doing? Did they come from helicopters and would they drop down? They marched across the sands of Rajasthan. What were we doing? We were saying, temples don't matter, images don't matter, our souls are the only things that matter to us. If this is the spirit of Hinduism, I think we will never win, not just the problem of Islam, tomorrow there will be the problem of Christianity, tomorrow there will be other problems, we will all be defeated by ourselves. This revival of the strength of India, the spiritual strength of India, which is not based on hatred, which is not based on division and schism, this has to be awakened. And I think Sri Aurobindo has given the lead. He has brought back to us the ideal of the Rishi. He has rejected the ideal of the ascetic. The Indian nation fell a victim to this ideal of the ascetic. Oh, the world doesn't matter to us. All that matters to us is God and the soul. The Rishi said, the world matters to us. We are here to bring perfection to the world. That needs strength. And it is this Hinduism, call it Hinduism, or this new human spirit is what is required, not just for this problem, but to make India once again whole and complete. Then, the next, Sri Aurobindo very clearly says, the problem of Islam is not a political problem, it's a national problem. The problem of overpopulation is not a political problem, it's a national problem. The problem of poverty is not a political problem, it's a national problem. We have to handle it as a national problem and not devise little gimmicks and little alliances and little short, you know, footnotes to the Constitution. That is not the way to solve these. Next, we should never gloss over the fact that there is at some level a conflict going on between the liberal spirit of Hinduism and the fundamentalism of Islam. And this has created problems. We should handle this conflict wisely, not wish it away. Not just feel that this doesn't exist. It does exist. People are exploiting it, and we must be careful and firm in handling problems which arise out of this conflict. Finally, as Sri Aurobindo said, Muslims should never be marginalized and looked upon as vote banks. They are our brethren. We should look into the real interests and they should be brought into the mainstream of national life. Finally, as I said, nobody can talk about the problem of Islam in India without referring to what Sri Aurobindo said in his 15th of August 1947 message, and you all know it, reading it on an occasion like this itself is a very, very useful thing. It helps to invoke the spirit of unity which Sri Aurobindo always stood for. He said, India is free, but she has not achieved unity, only a fissured and broken freedom. At one time, it almost seemed as if she might relapse into the chaos of separate states which preceded the British conquest. Fortunately, there has now developed a strong possibility that this disastrous relapse will be avoided. The wisely drastic policy of the Constituent Assembly makes it possible that the problem of the depressed classes will be solved without a schism or fissure. But the old communal division into Hindu and Muslim seems to have hardened into the figure of a permanent political division of the country. It is to be hoped that the Congress and the nation will not accept the settled fact as forever settled or as anything more than a temporary expedient. For if it lasts, India may be seriously weakened, even crippled. Civil strife may remain always possible. Possible even a new invasion and a foreign conquest. The partition of the country must go. It is to be hoped by a slackening of tension, by a progressive understanding of the need of peace and concord, by the constant necessity of common and concerted action, even of an instrument of union for that purpose. In this way, unity may come about under whatever form. The exact form may have a pragmatic but not a fundamental importance. But by whatever means, the division must and will go. For without it, the destiny of India might be seriously impaired and even frustrated. But that must not be. Those of us who have looked at the world, looked at the history of the world, the enmities between the British and the Germans, the British and the French, 100 years ago, what is called the British Channel was unthinkable. It required the bitter experience of 2 world wars to bring Europe together. Let us only hope and pray. Sri Aurobindo will not allow this to happen in this country. And before we pay this terrible, terrible price, the unity of this sacred land will once again be established. Thank you. Sacred land will once again be established. Thank you.